कैसे? बस फोन बस बता रहे।
F5 से खेल।
F5 नहीं तो अब बस मैं बोल के
करता हूँ
तो मुझे पता कैसे चलेगा कि बच्चे कौन कौन आ गए?
देखना
कोई आया
यहीं पे आ जाएंगे जैसे वो लॉग इन करना स्टार्ट करते हैं। अभी ये 2 बजे है ना।
अच्छा तो एक दो मिनट वेट कर लूँ पहले?
नहीं नहीं वो कुछ नहीं करना
आपको, एक बार आप फोन करके पूछ दीजिए है ना। मेरा भी फर्स्ट टाइम है, मैं भी फर्स्ट टाइम। आई थिंक लॉग इन करना स्टार्ट कर दिया।
हो गया
भूपेंद्र है स्टार्ट।
यही हमें साइन मिल जाता है
गुड आफ्टरनून चिल्ड्रेन एंड स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे दिस इज माई फर्स्ट लेक्चर ऑन वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंसिंग, सो वी माइट फेस सम डिफिकल्टी। द टू टॉपिक्स आर, फर्स्ट इज वर्जिनिटी, सेकेंड इज अननेचुरल सेक्शुअल ऑफेंसेस। फर्स्ट आई विल स्टार्ट विद वर्जिनिटी। सी बाय गोइंग बाय द नॉर्मल डेफिनेशन, हु इज अ वर्जिन? वर्जिन इज अ फीमेल हु हैज नॉट एक्सपीरियंस सेक्शुअल इंटरकोर्स। The word virgin is derived from the old French word virginie, which in turn originated from the Latin word virgo, meaning maiden or a sexually intact or a sexually inexperienced woman. But we all know in today's world and the modern era, this concept of virginity is obsolete. So, but by going by the definitions, defloration means loss of virginity. Now, where the virginity might come, it might come important in two civil matters. What are they? One is marriage, that is a contract between man and woman which implies physical union by coitus. Second is divorce. Divorce under section 13 of Hindu Marriage Act is the dissolution of previously held marriage. So in which medical legal cases virginity is important? In the nullity of marriage, it means the marriage is being nullified in the court of law. Divorce in defamation cases. Now earlier it was considered in rape also, but now in the new changes which after the lecture Dr. Adarsh will continue, in view of the new changes of criminal amendments in the rape law, now the virginity is not important and not required. Now what are the physical signs of virginity? In extragenital, the examination breast is not a very reliable sign. In genital examination, if we go by from outside, labia majora is thick, firm, round and elastic. It lies in a position and close the vaginal orifice. Labia minora is soft, small and pink. Vagina is narrow and tight, full of rugosity, reddish and sensitive. Now coming to the important aspect, that is hymen. Hymen is a partial diaphragm situated at the vaginal outlet. It is formed in the 4th month of fetal life. So what is hymen? It is a fold of mucous membrane about 1 millimeter thick, derived from the posterior vaginal wall with an anterior opening. In adults, normally it is annular or crescentic in shape. In children, it appears as a taut membrane. Taut means stretched or tight membrane. During puberty, it enlarges and appears as a series of folds. It is supplied with blood vessels which bleed on rupture. In virgin, it admits the tip of finger. Now, what are the different types and shapes of hymen? Semilunar or crescentric. Opening is placed anteriorly, present at the lateral and posterior margins of vaginal opening. Annular, another type is annular, that the opening is oval situated in the center and encircles the vaginal opening. So this is the form of crescentric hymen. See, this is hymen, this is vaginal opening, it is situated anteriorly, and this is the form of annular hymen, like vaginal orifices, and it is completely encircling the orifice. Now infantile, small linear openings in the center. I will show you figure after the slide. Cribriform, several openings are present. Vertical means vertical hymenal opening. Septate means two lateral openings side by side. Imperforate, no opening is present at all. Then fimbriated or notched means irregular edges are there. Now just having a figurative description. This is a septate hymen with two different openings. Cribriform with multiple openings. imperforate with no opening, and this is pars introitus after childbirth. The hymen is completely torn and the orifices is enlarged. Now, by going the difference between the fimbriated and ruptured hymen, this is a example of fimbriated hymen and this is a ruptured hymen. What are the difference? Fimbriated hymen is present anteriorly while ruptured is present posteriorly. Fimbriated hymen extend to the base of hymen, extend to the point of attachment of hymen to the edge of vagina. Shape is bilaterally symmetrical, the shape is asymmetrical and irregular. Mucous membrane over notches is intact, mucous membrane is torn and healed and it is not intact. What could be the causes of rupture of hymen? First is accidental falling on some pointed object, etc. Second is masturbation in teenage girls, foreign body, introduction of solar pith. This practice was used in the past in rural or you can say underdeveloped areas. Ulceration, some disease also might cause ulceration and leading to the rupture of hymen like diphtheria, repeated fungal infection. Then scratching, poor personal hygiene, due to poor personal hygiene, surgical and gynecological operations, sanitary tampons. Now, what is the diagnosis of virginity? Usually, by going by the convention, intact hymen indicates virginity. Exceptions are loose elastic hymen in which sexual intercourse might have been there, but the hymen is not torn, and thick, tough and fleshy hymen. Also, ruptured hymen can be found in virgins. Now, by going by the difference between virginity and defloration, hymen is intact, rigid and inelastic. In defloration, it is torn and intact. Edges are distinct and regular. Edges are irregular if torn. If intact, hymen is loose and elastic. The hymenal opening allows the tip of a finger to pass. Wide opening allows two or more fingers to pass. Labia majora is adjacent to each other, fully developed and completely closed the vaginal orifice. Labia majora is not opposed to each other, not prominent, and at the lower end, vaginal orifice may be seen. Labia minora are in contact and completely covered by the labia majora. In defloration case, they are not in contact but exposed. Fossa is intact, in this it is torn. Fossa navicularis is intact, in it this appears. Vagina is narrow, rugosity present, wall is more conical. After repeated intercourse, it becomes wide and rugosity decreases. Now, true virgins, hymen is intact. We are in our literature, it is distinguished like that. Otherwise, going by my personal opinion, I don't believe in this concept, true and false virgin. Hymen is intact and well stretched, edges is distinct and regular. Vaginal orifice is of small dimension, which permits the admission of terminal phalanx of a finger. Now, coming to the false virgins. Hymen is intact, but they have sexual intercourse. Hymen orifice lets one or two or more fingers to pass easily. Now, what are the medico-legal aspects? Presence of intact hymen is presumption, but not absolute proof of virginity. Now, in this, there is also one term which I would like to explain to you, and it is frequently asked in VIVAs, cariculum myritiforms. These are small, round, fleshy projection or tags around the hymenal ring in cases of destroyed hymens. Now, I think last Friday, the CR has distributed the lecture regarding the natural sexual offences from YouTube. But still, we'll have a quick overview on some points. Then Dr. Adarsh will continue on the natural sexual offences. Now, coming to the point, what is unnatural sexual offences, which are defined unnatural in terms of law. Law means Indian Penal Code. That is section. So, what is in Indian Penal Code? Why the unnatural sexual offences are described under section 377 IPC? What is section 377 IPC? Whosoever voluntarily has carnal intercourse against the order of nature with any man, woman or animal shall be punished with imprisonment for life or with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 10 years, and shall also be liable to fine. And just like in natural sexual offences, which you will know later, penetration is sufficient for the offender, not complete intercourse is required. Now, what are classifications? Sodomy or buggery, tribidism or you can say lesbianism, bestiality and buccal coitus. What is sodomy? It is generally, and by the going the common understanding, the term applied to the anal intercourse. It is derived from the ancient city of Sodom. That example has also been given in Bible, and the city was destroyed by the God because their misdeeds like sodomy, etc. Generally, it is in societies, it is found in prisoners, sailors, persons staying in a military barrack, hostels, etc. Now, going to the brief history, first record of sodomy as a crime at common law in England 1290, then later in Britain 1300. Then Act of Sodomy later became penalized by hanging under Buggery Act of 1533, which was again reenacted by Queen Elizabeth. Then in 1861, death penalty was formally abolished in England and Wales. And we all know our constitution is more of an adaptation of the British law. However, in sodomy or buggery remained as a crime not to be mentioned by the Christians. In India, now in view of current circumstances and law, sodomy implies a forceful intercourse. Any degree of penetration or any attempt of penetration is also punishable. Proof of emission of semen is not necessary. Voluntary anal intercourse is not decriminalized by the Honorable Supreme Court. If act is there with the consent obtained by the threat, coercion and or from the minor or an insane person, the consent is invalid. You will further know about the details in the natural sexual offences regarding the consent. In the English law, if one of the parties is under 14 years of age, then he is not guilty of offence. But it is not so in our judicial system. According to Hindu Marriage Act 1955, the marriage will be said to be annulled if the husband is found guilty of rape, sodomy or bestiality. Now, few terms. Male prostitute called eunuchs used to act as a passive agent. Hijras are those which have been castrated before puberty. Jananas are those in which genitalia are intact, but they act as a female passive agent, or they dress up like a female. Now, in passive agent, in adult it is called as gynecophilia, young boy pedestry, and in habitual they are called as catamite. Pedophile is an adult who repeatedly engages in sexual activities with children. Now, for the protection of children, we have POCSO Act, in which the child interests are both male and female, are less than 18 years of age, they are protected. You will further, in your further lectures, you will learn about it. Now, I will quickly go through the examination, because the examination pattern is more or less same as in the natural sexual offences. The passive agent, it is carried in proper light in knee elbow position, loss of elasticity and tone of anal muscles, pain and tenderness in the anal area, diffuse swelling of anal margins with obliteration of normal skin folds, abrasion and laceration over the near the anal area, anal fissures, blood, you can find blood and seminal stain. Material to be collected are from the inside and around the anus for microscopy, any loose pubic hair or lubricant. In habitual, how will you differentiate the habitual passive agent? The perianal skin is shaved, no pain or tenderness is present, skin around anus is smooth and thickened, loss of anal tone and disappearance of radial folds, funnel shaped depression of buttocks towards the anus, anus is dilated and papulous with loss of rugosity, anal fissure, piles and scars of old lacerations are present. You might find evidence of venereal diseases. But again speaking, a habitual agent can also say no, and forceful intercourse can be conducted on a habitual person. An active agent, what has to be done after crime, besides the normal examination that is conducted on the same pattern of the natural sexual offences. The other points are peculiar smell coming from the secretion of anal gland over penis, traces of fecal matter and lubricant on the organ, abrasion on the prepuce and glans penis, tearing of frenulum, blood and seminal stains might be present, sexual transmitted disease we can test for, marks of violence will be there on the body of the accused, clothing may have the seminal stains like undergarment or trousers. Now, quickly coming to the tribadism, because we have a very important and long lecture after this of natural sexual offences, so I am quickly glancing through these topics. So, tribadism is also called as lesbianism. It is named after the Isle of Lesbos. It is basically female homosexuality. Sexual gratification is obtained by the kissing, general body contact or manipulation of breast and genitalia. Consensual, again, is not punishable under Section 377 IPC. Non-penetrative forceful act might be punished under Section 354 IPC, outraging of modesty. Buccal coitus, it is named upon the sin of Gomor. Gomor used to be a town, and when God destroyed Sodom and Gomor towns. Usually male organ is inserted into mouth. What is fellatio? Fellatio, when male organ is sucked by the female or another male. Cunnilingus, when female organ is sucked by a male or another female. Now, so inserting your tongue inside a female genital organs also amounts to rape in the new Criminal Amendment Act 2013. So what are the findings in buccal coitus or forceful oral intercourse? Faint teeth marks and abrasion may be seen on a penis. The buccal swabs may be used to demonstrate sperm up to 9 hours. sometimes we have seen cases where accidental death has taken due to aspiration of semen, and to aspirate you just need a small thing in your respiratory tract, not huge bolus. In female and children it amounts to rape nowadays. To summarize, section 377 IPC has been interpreted to cover oral sex, anal sex and penetration of other natural orifices. Now last topic, bestiality. Sexual intercourse by a human being with animals like calves, sheep, she-ass, goats and larger birds like chicken, duck, etc. are conducted sometimes, so they come under the section of bestiality. Vaginal intercourse is generally commonly practiced by mentally deranged or perverted, now in the modern terminology you can say perverted individuals. Sometimes there is false belief of getting cure of STDs by having intercourse with animals. Actual coitus is rare because of the anatomical differences, only slight penetration or you can say attempt is there. Both human and the animal have to be examined, and sometimes they are being examined. In Delhi we examined them in the hospital near Motibagh flyover. What are the findings? Human spermatozoa in the vagina or anus of the animal, animal hair on the body or the clothing of the accused, abrasion on the genitals can also confirm the act of bestiality. Now I am ending with this slide. To consider an accused guilty of under section 377 IPC, it must be proved that the accused who had carnal intercourse with men, women or animal, such intercourse was against the order of the nature. Penetration, however little it may be, and the act was done by the accused voluntary. So by this, I think I will pass the lectures baton to Professor Adarsh sir. Just let me see how many students are present. Okay students, now goodbye and take care in the time of corona. Keep safe and keep healthy. Now Professor Adarsh sir will take over the class.
इसी में
हाँ इसको क्रॉस कर दो ना
हाँ बैठना चाहो बैठो ना जाओ हाँ ठीक है ठीक
हाँ तुम उधर देख लो
खुल तो जाए
ठीक है
सर ठीक हेलो Good afternoon, students. Yeah, we have been meeting after a long time during Corona. This everything has been, you can say, our whole life routine has been changed. So instead of having these normal dietetic lectures when we face each other, rather than that, we are now getting used to this kind of online teaching. In this context, I'm thankful to Mr. Piyush, your CR. Who last week just coordinated with me, and I think you must have seen those YouTube lectures. Plenty of my lectures are otherwise available on various topics of forensic medicine. So these unnatural sexual offences have been covered. Yes, last time I was having some other fixed appointments, so that's why I have shifted to this today's lecture. So after understanding the concept of this virginity and related aspect, now we are coming actually to the offense which we see quite often, very frequently. If you just see the newspaper, almost every day we see these cases of rapes and all those sexual, various types of sexual assault. So the commonest terminology what is used, the sexual offenses against women, the commonest is the rape. There has been significant changes what we used to study or learn rape prior to 2012 and after that. As you know, in 2012 there happened this Nirbhaya incident which has just changed everything regarding the rape, the concept of rape, the various definitions, how the examination process and everything. So if you just see the textbooks which are published say 2012 or earlier 2013-14, because this act came into force in 2013. So if you see, there is a lot of difference between the understanding of the concept of rape prior to 2013 or so and now what we are understanding. Actually it started just you see this started from somewhere 6 months before, As we know, this Nirbhaya incident happened on 16th July 2012. But this awareness, or you can say the various things related to the rape, they started happening. Of course, they were happening from a very early period, many years before. But actually, on 19th July 2012, that is around, say, 5 months before, the government looks to make rape laws gender neutral. Before that, it was used to be a gender specific, that means the rape, the offense of rape can be committed against the female only. So that's how you can say the understanding of the people as the society changed over a passage, over a period of time, started changing. So this thing was happening. And as we know that on 16th December, this happened, and this just shook the conscience of everybody, all the persons involved in the investigation process, in the crime delivery, justice delivery system. Everyone was concerned when this Nirbhaya case happened. And afterwards, as we know, the Justice Verma Commission was formed in the aftermath of that case. And at that time, I was the General Secretary of the Academy, so the Indian Academy of Forensic Medicine. So we were very much concerned, and since we were knowing that what are the various loopholes, we took this opportunity that how to plug all those loopholes and how to have a robust system of this investigation when it comes to the offense of rape. So we discussed on many forum, and we just tried to improve this system overall. And all these, and in these aspect, we made certain recommendations also to this Justice Verma Commission, because that commission was formed just to understand and revamp everything. Because everybody was knowing that now the rape laws needs to be amended. So this gave us opportunity, and we gave so many recommendations. I am pleased to share that almost all of the recommendation what we submitted to the Justice Verma Commission was accepted as such. And now what you see, the Criminal Amendment Act, and afterwards the intricacies related with that, so many things were incorporated in that. So afterwards, then in the March 2013, this anti-rape bill, this gets the Lok Sabha nod. And ultimately, on 2nd April 2013, this Criminal Law Amendment Act was passed and implemented with effect from 2nd April 2013. So I will just comment upon the salient features which were occurring before this amendment, what the general standing of the rape is there, and after this amendment, what happened. So as I discuss about the whether this offense is gender specific or gender neutral, even after this amendment, it remained gender specific. That means this offense is against only the females. It is not applicable against the males. For that, there is a natural sexual offense, the other category 377, and other kind of perversions on the different IPCs which we'll derive. So even after that, still it remains a gender specific crime. But when you go into the intricacies or the various subsections of the act, sometimes we feel that there is some kind of conflict. And simultaneously, in 2012, we had this POCSO, that is the prevention of offenses against the children. So that is called the POCSO Act 2012. So that also you can say came into picture almost at the same time. So that was to specifically deal with children, and that is the gender neutral. So if any child below 18 years of age, then in that case, the clauses or the sections of POCSO can also be applied. So sometimes it becomes confusing that whether the offense of rape is to be applied if it is if the person is below 18 years of age, or the POCSO is applied. So I think now its position is clear. Rape, we have got a definition. 18, below 18, both can be applicable depending upon the circumstances, but above 18, it applies only to the female. And that was, if you see the age of consent, that was the major departure from the previous act. before 2000, this amendment of this act in 2013, the age of the consent for the sexual intercourse used to be the 16 years. And this created a lot of problem when we are actually handling the case, and especially when we are appearing in the court while as a prosecution witness. So there were so many, you can say, lacunas in this, in that, because on one side we are saying that the age of the marriage is 18 years, and another side we are saying that okay, the age of sexual intercourse could be 16 years also. So there was a conflict in between those. So sometimes we were facing this kind of problem. So that was a major recommendation made by us. It was accepted that yes, now it has to be made uniform, as the age of consent for the sexual intercourse is 18 years. And this solved actually a lot of problems, because POCSO also, where again the age of the child was not, you can say, defined earlier. Sometimes depending upon the circumstances, the child was supposed to be 12 years also, it was treated as child. In some situation, 14 years also was treated as child, 16 years also was treated as child, and sometimes 18 years also was treated as child. So since both these acts came together, so you can say we could take care of many lacunas in our legal system. So the age of consent was settled at 18 years. Then it advocated for the enhanced punishment for the offense of rape, and as we understand that natural sexual offenses, we can categorize the sexual offenses into two categories, that is the natural sexual offenses and unnatural sexual offenses. The unnatural sexual offenses, that is 377, has already been covered by Dr. Abhishek. The natural sexual offenses, that it rape, incest and all, they are covered under 375 and 376. 375 defines the offense of rape, and 376 various subsections defines the punishment for the offense of rape. So now we have got these various subsections like A, B, C, D under the 375 IPC. What is that? A, that is the penetrates his penis to any extent into the vagina, mouth, urethra or anus of a woman, or make her to do so with him or any other person. So now you, if you see again, there is a, you can say the vagina is okay when we talk about the natural sexual offenses, of course it amounts to rape, but then this penetrates his penis to mouth, urethra or anus, this can also be tried under the offense of rape. So it is also covered under the offense of unnatural sexual offenses, sodomy, depending upon the age of the person, as well as the POCSO, and here also. So still we can say that in due course of time, maybe we may have you can say further amendments also to the various subsections. So mouth, urethra or anus of a woman, or makes her to do so with him or any other person. So that's the first class. Then inserts any object. So it is not only the male organ. If it inserts any object, like you can say the finger, or as happened in the Nirbhaya, the bottle, or any object, external object, if it inserted into the genital organs, then also it will amount to the offense of rape. Manipulates any part of the body. Manipulation by mutual, by hand or by mouth, and all these things you can say is covered under the subsection A. Applies his mouth to the vagina, anus, to further clarify. And then it has further explained also that what is the vagina. It includes the labia majora, that is, that also includes the labia majora, because sometimes in one of the cases, I can remember this problem, this situation arose when the defense, when the accused said that I have not inserted my male organ into the female vagina of the inside the vagina. In fact, I was just rubbing this my male organ over the labia majora. So there was no defined, you can say, IPC for that. But now it has been clarified that the vagina also includes the labia majora. So just touching of the labia majora by the male organ also constitutes the offense of rape. Then the consent, it has to be unequivocal. right? It is not deemed to be accepted. It has to be an explicit proper consent. And of course, the whole offense of rape, you can say when we talk about, it's a basically a legal term. It's not a medical diagnosis. So ultimately, it depends upon the court how they view that at the time of sexual intercourse, whether the lady consented or not. Now, there are certain exceptions in this clause also. They are, if suppose the person or the victim is wife. So, of course, we know that after 16, now we have got the amendment of age up to 18 years. But in case of wife, it is still remains at 15 years of age. So again, that becomes a little bit problematic that on one side, we are saying the legal age of marriage for a female is 18 years. But in this particular clause or offense of rape, this says that the consent with wife, if it is below 15 years of age, only then it will be treated as rape and otherwise not. If the suppose the wife is 16 years, so then that will not count towards the offense of rape. So if she is married, so then this becomes a little bit controversy. So whether the marriage itself is illegal or this offense, how to apply, this problem arises. Then all these medical procedures and interventions which involves the any operation on the female vaginal tract or any intervention, or sometimes we have seen the vagina, this hymen and all had been removed by certain procedures, and whether during that examination process, if suppose that is the stern and all, so if suppose doctor is doing some paravaginal examination by finger, so whether that will constitute offense of rape or not, because if you see the first clause, it amounts to the offense of rape. So, but then no, if the doctor is doing this, of course it will not amount to rape. So that has been clarified and that has been made as an exception. So there should not be any, you can say, confusion about this, because when this act was to be, you can say, we were discussing, so this problem arose. So now on the punishment part, so now we are having this enhanced punishment as well as fine also, which was not earlier before this amendment. Now we have got the specific fine, monetary fine also, that the victim needs to be compensated by way of the monetary compensation in addition to the award of criminal punishment to the accused. The fine, monetary fine also to be given by the accused. So we have got various clauses, and depending upon the situation, so if the victim is in permanent vegetative state, so then this punishment may be 20 years of imprisonment. The sexual offense with wife during separation, suppose there is a divorce proceedings and the wife is not living with the husband, and if the husband forcefully tries, then this will also constitute the offense of rape. The punishment may vary, but then this will constitute the offense of rape. The person in position of authority, if he misuses or abuses his position, again that's an enhanced punishment. And again this has been defined that authority means, say suppose in a situation of prisoner, jail, the jailer is there, is in a position of authority, and if he abuses his position and has the sexual intercourse with a female prisoner, then he is abusing his position of authority. And then it will also amount to the enhanced punishment. Same thing is applied to any hospital institutions also. So if any doctor or paramedics and any person, if he uses his position, abuses his position and entices the girl or the female to have the sexual intercourse by abusing his authority, that will also amount to offense of rape and having with the enhanced punishment. And then gang rape, of course, when there is more than one person is involved, then both are guilty of offense of rape, and the accordingly the punishment will be more than 20 years of imprisonment and so. In case of repeat offenders, if the person is found to be second offender or the more time, then the punishment may be a life sentence instead of 20 years, or it may be in many cases, depending upon the heinousity of the crime, it may be death penalty may also be awarded. and then certain amendments were made like 166B and 357 CRPC, that is the Criminal Procedure Code. They were also amended along with the Indian Penal Code, which deals with primarily with the punishment part. So in this, they mandated that whenever the female, this victim of rape, comes to any of the hospital, whether it is a government or private, the treatment has to be mandatorily provided by that hospital. After providing the treatment, only for the medico-legal part, the victim will be referred to the concerned jurisdiction. Because earlier this practice was rampant, that in this type of scenario, most of the, you can say, the private hospitals, they were reluctant to take this kind of victim, and they immediately they used to refer it to the government hospital. And during that, you can say, we have seen even the cases when the victim was profusely bleeding and they simply didn't do anything, and they referred to the government hospital. The government hospital was, say, 100 kilometers away, and by that time the lady reached there, she died. So to avoid all these kind of things, they made the amendments in the Criminal Procedure Code also, that treatment in all these cases, that will supersede all the medico-legal proceedings, and that is mandatory to be given by all, irrespective of the status of the hospital. Whether it's a government, of course, it has to be, but even it applies for the private hospitals also. When we discuss about the natural sexual offences, related offence which invariably comes into picture is the indecent assault. So other than 375, see 376, which deals with the punishment, and 377, which deals with the unnatural sexual offences, we have got 354 IPC. Again, there are A, B, C and D, four sections, which deals with the indecent assault. So if you see, before 2012, that only one section was there, 354, and that was just defining the indecent assault. Now again, we have got four sub-clauses, and everything has been, you can say, to cover these specifically, which were earlier but not there. So 354A deals with the sexual harassment. That is the outraging the modesty of a female, even in the you can say, government institutions, with any employees also, this clause will be applicable. So, and the B, 354B deals with the assault, indecent assault, that is disrobing of a female. If forcefully, if the female is disrobed, even the sexual offense may not occur. So if disrobing also, it will be covered under 354B. Then voyeurism, that means the watching a female naked while changing the clothes or taking bath or having this intercourse, whatever. So this will be treated as an offense under the clause 354C, voyeurism, and it will be awarded 1 to 3 years of imprisonment along with the fine. And if the in case of repeat offense, this punishment may be enhanced to 3 to 7 years and with fine also. Then 354D deals with the stalking, and this is the, you can say, the punishment is up to 5 years of imprisonment. And we know by the general, you can say, knowledge, that all these things are very, very rampant in our society. When we talk about these stalking, one case I could remember, the molestation, this is also one of the variety, or you can say the variety of indecent assault. Of course, it happened much earlier, and in there also this 5 years imprisonment was awarded. And this infamous case belonged to a very senior Director General of Police from Haryana cadre. It happens around 15 years back, 2005 or so, Ruchika case. Even if you Google it, you may find it. And he was the first person by who was, you can say, punished for this particular offense. Before that, of course, the offenses was happening, but it never came into the picture, or you can say it never came into the limelight, so that cognizance of the offense was could be taken. So this was the first landmark case when this was addressed to. Then, of course, as I told you, the child sexual abuse cases, 2012, we have got the whole act. And only this last week, I was just going through some news, some amendments have further been made into this POXO Act just to plug all those loopholes. So you can just Google it and find very easily. Just this within a week itself, this last week itself, we have got certain amendments in this act. Then sexual jealousy crime also, which related with that, is one of the very, very common, that is called acid attack or the vitriolage, that has again been defined separately by inserting this clause A and B. 326 was there since ages, since 1860 when the IPC was formed. And then we had this 326 A and B just to specifically deal with the problem of vitriolage, that is acid attack. And I think you can remember only this year in the month of January, I can remember probably 2020 we started with that movie Chapak, when this Deepika Padukone and that movie was based upon that actual victim who is residing in fact in Delhi itself, the Lakshmi. She is there, and on her real life story, this film was made, Chapak. So this was the problem of vitriolage, and actually it was in her, you can say, case that these issues of compensation, monetary compensations, and to be provided by the various district legal services or state legal services authorities to these type of victims also to be dealt. So one is of course the punishment part, which was enhanced through amendment of this act by inserting these two clauses A and B, up to 10 years or maybe life imprisonment also can be awarded depending upon the heinousity of the crime, as well as fine also to be paid by the accused in this situation. And sexual harassment at workplace, up to 3 years imprisonment can be awarded, again depending upon the case to case. And then also it was advocated to have an in-house mechanism so that all those type of cases in every government institute should be disposed of within 90 days of the lodgement of the complaint. So we'll just go further. This, as I told you, the rape is one of the important offenses, or when we study the sexual assault, it is the, you can say, foremost offense which comes to our mind, and we need to understand what exactly it is. As I told you, it is a legal term, it is not at all a medical diagnosis. So ultimately it has to be decided by the Honorable Court depending upon consent and all those eyewitnesses, the statement of the victim and all those things. So what is the role of doctor in current scenario? Yes, it is the very basic purpose of examination of a victim of a offense of rape is here. What is the role of doctor? He will corroborate the victim's account in the court of law. So whatever by the, you can say, alleged history and all, when the lady comes for the examination, you will record that history in proper detail, and then depending upon your finding, you will corroborate whatever she is saying, whether it is consistent what you have observed on the examination of that victim. And this will aid in the investigation as well as the prosecution of the accused. And it helps both ways, either to prove or to exclude a physical connection between the individuals and objects or places depending upon case. And of course, it determines the occurrence of a recent sexual activity. So all these four things are required when we deal the offense of rape. So doctor helps in establishing all these, you can say, four pillars of the investigation process of offense of rape. So how we do that? First, to identify the assailant. That is also one of the purpose. If suppose some findings are there on the victims, and how I will come to that later. Establishing the use of force or resistance, if the use of force has been applied by the accused and the victim has resisted, so there will be some signs of a struggle over the body, and then that will be established by the medical examination. Indicating an inability to consent, because this becomes important when we talk about rape. The whole thing revolves around the concept of consent. So if the consent is given due to the under the influence of alcohol or under the influence of any drug, or if the lady is otherwise having a diminished mental capacity, then also the consent given by that girl or that female will not be treated as a legal consent. In that situation, so even if the lady has consented, that will amount to a, you can say, illegal consent, and this clause will not stand there. So the doctor will help by establishing all those, by having again the analysis whether the victim is under the influence of alcohol or drugs, or she is having some diminished mental capacity. So again, here is the role of examination by the doctor comes into picture. And of course, as I told you, the first and foremost is the medical responsibility as a doctor that precedes all the medico-legal formalities. So in case of any, you can say, danger to the life of the victim, the first is to resuscitate and stabilize her condition. If suppose she is profusely bleeding and all, so or sometimes we have seen the torn perineal region and all, so then that becomes precedent. So first to have to save the life of the victim, so that needs to be done first, and after that when this the person is settled, then comes the medico-legal responsibility when we talk about the various types of collection of evidences like clothing, which is one of the most important piece of evidence, because we understand that there may be so many biological fluids like semen and biological materials like hair and all that may be found over the clothing, and even the circumstantial evidences may be there which will show the struggle process, there may be torn. So all these things by examination of clothing we can examine. So clothing needs to be preserved by the doctor. Then alleged history of incident, whatever the victim is saying, whether it is corroborating with the findings or not. And then as we have seen over a period of time, that this history taking, when we talk about this offense of rape, this is a very you can say it's a different art. It's not a usual medical history taking which you just ask from this previous illness. Of course, that will be also part of that. In this particular scenario, you have to ask a very specific history of the incident, what is happened. So that's a whole you can say long process, how to take a proper history. Only then you can correlate or interpret those findings with the on the person's on the victim's body. And sometimes we need to also determine the age also, if the girl the alleged age of the girl or the victim is less than 18 years, because if the girl is less than 18 years, of course the validity of the consent will not be there. As I told you, this is changed to 18 years, so the age also needs to be determined. So if the girl is found to be below 18, even if she consents for the sexual intercourse, it will not amount to the consent and it will be treated as an offense of rape. Along with that, as a long term management, we also need to counsel the patient or the victim, because she is mentally, you can say, very disturbed, tortured, so she needs a proper rehabilitation also. And in case of pregnancy, we have to follow it up whether after offense of rape, if suppose lady got pregnant, because many of the times we have seen the victim is coming to us for a gap of say 2, 3, 4, 5 days, and by that time she might have concepted also. So in that case we need to have this examination, so whether to continue with the pregnancy or terminate the pregnancy. Again, it varies from you can say situation to situation. If the lady has contracted some sexually transmitted disease, then also it is our responsibility to treat that disease also. So it is not only the examination of the victim for the you can say the only for the evidence collection, the responsibility of a medical person is in fact much more than that. And having this concept of holistic care, now we are seeing this concept of one-stop care center developing all over the India. And in fact, that was an important recommendation in 2013 But after you can say now after you can say that after 6 years or six more than 5-6 years, now the things have started moving, and now we are talking about whether we can have this according to jurisdiction, the various centers, one-stop care centers, where everything, all the care can be given at one particular place, rather than sending the victim to some, you can say, different departments. So when we talk about the consent for this victim for examination, again this becomes problematic. As I told you that this consent is different from the consent for the sexual intercourse. Here, as a doctor, you are seeking the consent for the examination of the victim, but for the private parts, right? Because for that, again, you have to take the consent of the victim. In that scenario, many of the times we have seen that the girl is not giving the consent for the examination because of so many factors. Sometimes she is mentally shattered and she doesn't want to, you can say, listen to anyone. She just becomes hysterical, crying, weeping. So of course she will not consent. So again, that becomes a very difficult scenario. So you have to go by the case whether she can give the consent. If she is giving consent, you will explain that, okay, I am going to examine you for these things. And if she gives the consent in writing, only then you will proceed. Otherwise, if she has refused to give the consent for the examination part, you as a doctor cannot proceed and you will simply document it. Sometimes the question also poses a problem that who can give consent, whether it is the victim herself or some accompanying person like mother or father or any other person who is accompanying, especially if the victim is less than 18 years. If it is more than 18 years, then of course the consent has to be given by the victim itself. But below 18 years, it creates problem, it creates confusion that whose consent will be treated as valid. So again, we have to go by the situation. It's a very complicated scenario, everything I cannot cover in this particular lecture. When you talk about the examination of accused, so as I told you, when you talk about the examination of victim, of course we cannot examine the victim if she is not giving the consent. But in the case of victim, this section 53A of the Criminal Procedure Code, this empowers the registered medical practitioner or the doctor. So in that scenario, if accused is brought for the examination in particular offense, if he is booked under 375 or 377, of course depending upon which situation, so in that, if the offense is properly booked and the request is made by a person, by investigating officer not below the rank of sub inspector, in that scenario examination of accused even with reasonable force can be done, because in that scenario the force application is necessary to obtain certain facts or to collect certain evidences. So in that scenario, even with the reasonable force, we can go ahead with the examination process of an accused, right? But even then it becomes problematic in some scenario. If suppose he is not giving the consent, then who will apply the reasonable force, whether it is the doctor whose duty is to apply force, or it is the IO, or it is the police constable, or it is the ward boy or nurse, who will apply? Again, that becomes, there are no clear cut answers for that. We have to counsel and we have to go from by situation. Role of a doctor becomes especially important when we talk about examination and collection of these biological evidences. If they are there, they are very helpful in determining the, you can say, establishing the chain of the custody, like the blood and blood stains, the semen, the swabs, the sputum and sweat, the hair samples, the fingernail scrapings. Because when we talk about these things, these biological evidences needs to be preserved if they are there, so that they can be correlated with the victim. By this, especially use of this modern scientific techniques, especially with the advent of DNA profiling, when we undertake, and we can link the accused with the victim and with the crime. So there are certain procedures that, yes, in these things, all things have to be meticulously documented, and all those the injuries which are there on the person or on the victim, that should be again documented properly. And if she is having some kind of mental problem, it invariably happens, she must also be counseled and giving a proper psychological treatment, because we have seen there is a postmortem traumatic stress disorder is there, invariably the female develops, so we have to counsel her also, and we have to go in a very sympathetic, humane manner. It's not mechanical that, okay, if any victim has come to you and you will immediately ask that, okay, I'm going to examine it, remove your cloth, go there. It's not like that. You have to handle it in a very sympathetic manner. And there should not be any delay in the examination of the victim, because the delay invariably will lead to the loss of biological evidences, and court has taken even cognizance for that, and that it is not to be, you can say, delayed in any situation. And again, this practice of examination, that if the doctor is male or female, again, this is a relatively, you can say, problematic area. If you talk about the Indian scenario, there is a lot of variation between different states also. So if I share my experience of this particular thing, if you see the northern part of the country, here invariably the victim of the rape will be examined by a female doctor, as per this, you can say, the Punjab Haryana High Court ruling of 2002, and then after course the gazette notification was made in 2005. So it is specifically mentions that the lady, the victim must be examined either by a lady doctor, female doctor. It doesn't mention that it should be a gynecologist. It should be a lady doctor or in presence of a female attendant. But ironically, in northern part of the country, this is only taken as, the first clause is taken as applicable. So they insist that in the lady doctor will only examine. But if you go in other part of India, like I can remember this state of Maharashtra, state of Goa, Mumbai, and southern states, the Karnataka, Kerala, there, these, even the male doctor can examine. Suppose the forensic expert, and many of the places it goes to the forensic medicine department. So in forensic medicine department, if male doctor is there, he can examine, of course, then he will use the other clause, and a female attendant will be there, a neutral attendant. It may be a nurse, it may be any person, it may be even the, you can say, the medical student also, that will act. So just to assure that, okay, in the presence of a female person, the examination is being done. But then, as I told you, India is a huge country, so that practice varies from state to state. And these are various, you can say, guidelines also are there. As I told you, the history taking in this particular scenario is a very specific art, because victim is already traumatized, and we need to have a very humane approach. To have that, you can say, first to develop a rapport with the victim, because she is in an already traumatized state. So she's not going to confide you or to give you exact history on the very first interaction. And especially if you are a male, right? So then it's an art. So how to develop that? So we can divide this history into general history and the specific history. General history, of course, will cover everything pertaining to the medical aspect also, like history of menarche, the last menstrual period, and all those things. Then the specific history, as far as the offense of rape is concerned, then this becomes, you can say, very important and very specific. There you are supposed to ask about the place, date, and time of alleged act, because your finding will accordingly vary at what time you are examining from the time of offense. Then history about the clothing, whether they are same or changed, invariably we have seen that the victim, when it reaches to hospital, she is not wearing the clothings which were worn at the time of offense, at the time of rape. So if suppose those clothings you are preserved or you examine, you are not going to find anything. So that history becomes important only when you ask specifically whether these clothings, whether you have worn this clothing, whether you have changed or not. If it is same clothing, of course that needs to be examined and preserved, so that you will hand it over to the police person, and afterwards it will be submitted to the FSL for the examination, because you know there could be blood, semen and other things. But if it is changed, then also that needs to be documented. Invariably we have seen that the police already has collected that. So when you are writing the specific history in your report, MLC report, then you have to mention it specifically. Otherwise, what we have seen in many of the cases, because of, you can say, the maintaining a proper chain of custody or not writing a proper history, the defense takes that lacuna, exploits that lacuna, and the case falls. Then the history of taking bath. If suppose the lady has taken bath after the offense of rape, invariably all those biological evidences are going to be lost. So it needs to be documented whether she has taken bath after the offense of rape or coming directly to you and she has not taken bath after the offense of rape and it is your first examination. So then of course you can correlate all those findings. History of ejaculation, that is also important, whether the accused has ejaculated or not. Suppose he has not ejaculated, so where is the question of semen in that scenario, right? So afterwards the DNA report is going to be negative if there is no ejaculation. So that history is important. If the lady, if the victim can tell this history, that helps in the corroboration. So as I told you, as a doctor we can corroborate all these scientific evidences. And here again, in ejaculation, this specific history about the use of condom is also necessary. That okay, he might have ejaculated, but suppose if the accused has used condom, so all the semen will remain in the condom. So even this, the rape has occurred, but then this semen is not there, and so semen is in fact inside the condom. So that needs to be examined. So that history becomes important. So if the lady can tell, then you can document it and you can accordingly guide also police for further, you can say, investigation or further collection of various evidences. And if the lady has struggled, screamed or injured the assailant in any way, suppose during that process, suppose she has made some scratches over the face or any part of the accused and she tells that, then again it becomes important. So when the accused is caught, that correlation with the her history and the findings again will be correlated. So when we talk about the examination of clothing, then again that has to be removed by the victim herself or accused. It is not the job of the doctor to do that. You will just examine that once it is removed, whether you will see for any swelling or tears or any evidence. If you find, you will collect that, encircle it, mark that and put the initials, your signatures or your case number, doctor's name, so that the chain of custody is maintained. The proper privacy should be given to a female victim. She should be asked to stand on a white paper or a big white chart paper, so that whatever during the process of undressing, if some biological evidences are there, especially the hair, so if they will fall on the white paper, you can easily visualize them and you can collect them. So that's the whole idea. So this will prevent the loss of various trace evidences. And if there are any wounds, so that needs to be documented both in victims and accused. And if there are facilities for the photographs, they should be taken properly. Right, of course there are confidentiality issues in that, so we have to follow proper guidelines how to take the photograph, not to reveal the identity of the victim at any stage, but it should be number and all, whatever. So it needs to be documented properly and it will support your whatever writing of the report as well. Then collection of blood in all those scenarios is essential for the screening of alcohol, or if some history of if she has been given some drugs or some drug facilitated sexual assault are there, some drugs are there, especially the rave parties and party drugs, if that has been given. So again, by analysis of blood, we can know if some substance is being given. So if the lady is saying that, the victim is saying that I was given some stupefying substance or some drug under the effect, I became unconscious and then afterwards the sexual intercourse was done on me. So in fact, I had not consented, I was under the influence of that drug. So whatever consent the defense is saying, I have not given the consent. In fact, I was given forcefully this drug. So that will support this statement. So all these scenario, the examination, the collection of the blood is required and submitted to FSL for the examination process. In accused also, it becomes important if she under the influence. So when we do this various examination by this photograph, you can very easily remember if you can just see this photograph. So you can just remember, you can examine in a chronological manner from top to head and you will see the injury to the head. If suppose there, so you can note that redness and swelling of the eyes, because these are the findings which you usually are found in an offense of rape. So you will have to concentrate more on these aspects. Of course, any findings will be necessary to be documented, but here you will specifically look for all these, because these are the more likely injuries or more likely scenario in an offense of rape which you will see in a case of victim. So there could be abrasion and bruises and lacerations over face, throat, breast, inner side of these thighs, right, and these hands, the forearm, wrist, if suppose she has been overpowered, so you will see that. And of course the nails also, there could be during the struggle, the legs, ankle, if some force is applied. So these are areas where you will find injury. So accordingly, you can collect various biological evidences from all these areas. Like scalp, you can collect head hair if something is there. Saliva, you can collect. Invariably, it will give this DNA from that. And the swabs from the bites, if some bite is there, then it is expected that we might get the DNA of the accused from those swabs. Some blood stains are there, that needs to be collected. Any foreign material, the nail clippings, the urine, and the swabs from the soiled areas, right? And these are the specific areas you should look for injuries in a case of, you can say, forceful penetration for or the offense of rape. Because here, if the lady usually will be caught by this arm region, so you will expect these abrasions. They are minute, you can say, abrasion or bruises, but it will be found on that area in this particular manner. Right, abrasions on the lower back from rough surface. So these are the areas where specifically, and if this area, this shows specifically or points towards the you can say signs of a struggle. And then in the private part, again you will specifically look for any vaginal swelling, redness, abrasion, bruising, and hymenal tear if that can occur in a case of offense of rape. Some perineal injuries, scratches are there, and accordingly you can collect the various biological evidences also. Like if suppose some semen is there, after drying the semen you will find this hair will become matted, and you will cut the hair from the base. And these otherwise you can do the combings of the pubic hair if hair are there. So that will give the evidence of foreign hair also from the accused sometimes, and as well as the semen also in case of mated hair. And the various you can say swabs from these area where there are chances of getting the semen, and so that swabs must be taken from all these areas, and also from the anal region, because the situation is like that after the offense of rape, if suppose some seminal discharge is there, it will trickle down and it may be deposited at the anal region. So it may not be a case of sodomy, but still you will find the semen might be deposited there. So anal swabs also needs to be you can say collected in all these scenarios. And this is the, you can say, usual findings what we see, the genital injuries. So all these needs to be collected, various number of swabs from different regions, and now we have got a specific pre-packaged these kits, what we called as safe kits, sexual assault forensic examination collecting kits, so that all these there should not be any contamination, and it will help in proper collection and preservation of the various material evidences, and how far from which area this shows that how many swabs needs to be collected, and which manner to have a proper scientific collection of the semen, because after for want of this even if it is a case of rape, you because of your poor examination or poor collection you will miss all those findings. So that all needs to be collected and sent to biological examination for forensic science labs of the concerned jurisdiction, what we have. And additionally, depending upon case scenario, depending upon the history, you may find the additional evidences in suppose beddings are there, if some is there, so blankets, bed sheet and pillow covers also, if that is the place of incident, that also needs to be collected, and sometimes we can even recover the DNA material from these areas. Cigarette butts, suppose during the smoking the person has thrown those butts, so the cigarette will have that saliva of the accused, and this will correlate the presence of accused from the place to the victim. So from there also we can you can say separate the DNA. The condoms, as I told you, if suppose offense has happened on the moving car, as we see in the metro so many cases, the alleged history is this rape has been committed on the car seats, moving car. So in that, even the car seats also can give you can say the biological evidences here also, and in addition to the semen. So toothpicks, chewing gum, toothbrush, beer bottles, cups, soft drink cans, eyeglasses, socks, bangles, rings, all these at the place of you can say incidents, if they are found, then they becomes important for correlating the presence of victim and accused and the whole chronology of the events. So it looks simple, but it may sometimes the IO even overlook that, oh, these are of no use. But you as a forensic expert, you know that even these small evidences also are very, very important and helps a lot in the you can say dealing with the case. Similarly, these from the accused also we can the examine from top to bottom, and again we can collect all these various evidences. So again you have to concentrate on the various parts. And this sodomy, of course, it will be done in a different portion, and in that you will concentrate more on the collection from, and as Dr. Abhishek has already covered, in a habitual person, habitual victim of sodomy, all these findings will be different in a you can say habitual passive agent and those. So that needs to be preserved, and certain precautions need to be taken. Proper preservation, appropriate storage in bags, and how that should be done, I think it's a huge massive topic. It in any case it cannot be covered in a single lecture, at least it needs two or three lectures, but I just tried to hurry that don't pack in the polythene. So the paper bags are better because this will hamper with the DNA investigation process, and because the contamination of the DNA evidences is very much a problematic issue. So we have to use all those proper methods of collecting of evidence and proper documentation by making all those proper signing, date and all those. So and collecting, giving it to whom, because invariably we have seen the cases fall because there is a very, very casual entries. There is no proper entries, even the doctor have not signed even proper some kind of you can say googies, or you can say some initial have been made and nothing is there that which doctor, who has collected evidences, who has submitted all those things. So you have to you can say cover to collect all these things, and as I told you, these various DNA collection kits are also now there, and for DNA now it can be stored for 10 years or even more at these cards. And even we have a database, and even after some time this victim, the accused can be caught, so it can be compared. So with the advancement of you can say technology, we are moving gradually towards more and more you can say foolproof scientific methods. A determination of course is an issue in if suppose the it's a borderline case, or if the alleged age of the victim is less than 18 years, then again our role as a doctor enhanced further, and then we have to have the all the processes for age determination, like general examination, dental examination, radiological examination, everything, and then to give as minimum age range as possible, because we know that we cannot pinpoint the age. We as a doctor can just you can say minimize the age range, suppose 16 to 17 years, 17 to 18 years, or like that depending upon case. Sometimes even that becomes difficult. And if suppose some impending death is there, then as a doctor you will try to arrange for the dying declaration, because that is very important part of any criminal proceedings, as you know. And in case of any death, of course the dead body has to be subjected for the medico-legal autopsy and not to be given to the relatives before that. And when we talk about the opinion giving in that, so as a doctor, as I told you, rape is a legal term, it's not a medical diagnosis. We never say that rape has occurred. We only give the opinion in all these, you can say, four parts: what was the age of victim or survivor, the signs of recent vaginal penetration, or there in any signs of physical injury or struggle, and whatever the signs or the injuries are there, whether they are consistent with the alleged history. What are the comprehensive negative and positive findings? What are the laboratory and radiological findings? And of course, nowadays this two finger test, which was used to be earlier, if you see the old movies, they were used to be very fond of you can say throwing this on the female, the character, the character assassination used to be a very common thing in olden days, the prior to that definition. So now the things have changed, and that's why we say we have changed our all those, you can say, collection methodology and all those. So previously it used to be a very common two finger test, now it has been outdated and banned by the Supreme Court. So, and even we have seen even the false charges have been made sometimes just to, you can say, extort the money also, and all those issues are there. So sometimes the false charges also to be there, and then with the inconsistency of statements and the corroboration of findings, we can come to the conclusion that there may not be, and you can say the findings are not suggestive of that. And we have even conducted one case where this was alleged to be a false case, she alleged, but then afterwards when we tried to do that, we came to know that she was trying to frame that. And then we talk about the trial, of course, that is a different kind of trial in these scenario. All those rape cases, the victims, there is a separate kind of trial goes on, which we call as in-camera trial. So in-camera means it's not a, you can say, some kind of camera proceedings. It's basically a confined room. So in that room, only the victim will be there, and her lawyer and PPP will be there, right? Accused and victim, they will never come face to face. Accused will be on the other side, barricading will be there, and all this. And only judge, victim and accused, and maybe some or sometimes accused at that time, depending upon what stage of statement it is. So only those persons are there and no other person is allowed. That is called as in-camera trial. So different proceedings rather than the normal. So I hope you would have understood the little bit the concept and role of this as a doctor of ours in case of examination of a rape victim, rape accused, and all these sexual offenses. In any case, in any query, you can always reach to me. Any clarification at all, of course, so many my YouTube videos on not only this topic, other topics are also available. So you can use your time, utilize your time in this current era of COVID-19 pandemic by seeing those, whosoever is interested more, by seeing those YouTube videos. I think Vidya Mitra and all those link I have already shared with your CR, Mr. Piyush. And so you can just go through, and of course you will learn a lot by going through all these things. So thanks a lot for your patient listening. I hope you would have understood this complicated concept of this rape in this 1 hour 10 minutes or so. I tried to just hush it up and cover it up everything. Thanks a lot for your patient listening. I'm always there for any kind of queries and all. Thank you. Done? Exit हुआ
अभी ठीक मैं कर दूँगा.
अच्छा और तो कुछ नहीं करना?
कॉपी पेस्ट तो किया ही नहीं था.
हैं
कॉपी पेस्ट नहीं किया था?
कॉपी पेस्ट नहीं
किया, डायरेक्ट किया था.
हाँ डायरेक्ट किया. ठीक है काफ़ी है. कितने स्टूडेंट हैं
देखो ये
80 के आसपास है. चलो ठीक है.